Hi, this is Lynn and
Richard
from WisconsinGarden.com, and we are very excited today because we're starting a new project. Now, sometimes I get the ideas for starting new projects, and sometimes Rick gets the idea for starting a new project, and that's what happened this time. Because during our research on how best to grow your garden, we've always added flowers, marigolds and sweet alyssum, to our vegetable gardens to attract pollinators, and we were thinking honeybees. And of course, most people know there is a problem with honeybees and the decrease in their population. So as Rick was studying that one day on the internet, he came across something that was very, very interesting.
I call them the super pollinators. And I guess it's going to be a project that is dear to my heart because I appreciate all the work you do in the garden, all the beautiful flowers you grow, and your planting techniques and so forth. And I've always been fascinated by how these things really get pollinated. Not that it's, any new revelation to anybody. But when I started doing research on and asking questions, well, what's happening to our honeybee pollinators? You know, why are they dying in such huge numbers? And who's going to replace them? So, we, as human beings, we rely on food, obviously, as our main source. Food, water, shelter, the basic things in life. And if we don't do something, if we don't take an active role and start doing something, whatever it is we can do, we're part of the problem. I mean, we're the ones eating this food, right?
Right, and some of our gardening practices have caused part of the bee problem.
Yeah. Well, you think about how habitats have been destroyed. I mean, you go to these maps, when you fly over the country and you see these open spaces, you don't have these tree lines anymore. You don't have these places where a bee or even animals can really rest and, develop, their lifestyles and so forth. So we've destroyed a lot of habitat. And that's why I believe the home gardener is really going to help out. In fact, the company that we're learning from is called Crown Bees. I'll have their website scrolling below. But they have a huge goal. They want to help educate 1 million gardeners and encourage them to start raising these super pollinators, which we'll describe in just a moment here. They want to get into, I think it's 250,000 schools and also with 250,000 nurseries. So really to educate people about these incredible solitary mason bees. They're called a blue orchard mason bee. Just to give you an example. You have a honeybee. It goes out, flitters out, crawls around a flower and then starts to gather all the pollen on their body and then they start licking it off, putting it on their legs.
Well, they lick it to keep it so it sticks to them so they can carry it back to their hive and feed their workers.
And of course, honeybees produce honey. I mean, that's part of their mission. And they are a hive colony. They're a colony.
Social bee.
Social bee. And everybody has their job. Just like a bumblebee, Now, a bumblebee, I learned, is actually gathers pollen 400 times faster than a honeybee. 400 times faster than a honeybee.
Well, they are bigger.
And every time they're buzzing, they're really vibrating the flowers, so all that pollen actually lands on their body. And they, too, use their spit to attach it to their legs to take it back to their hive. Now, honeybee hives obviously are bigger than the bumblebee hive because I think bumblebee hives range about 150 to maybe 200, somewhere in that range.
And I don't believe we eat bumblebee honey.
No.
I don't think they're known for their honey production.
So, that led to two incredible bee species. In fact, there are over 4,000 bee species in North America, 4,000 different species. Honeybee is one, bumblebee is another. And then we got to the blue orchard mason bee. Talk about a super pollinator. One blue orchard mason bee does the work of 100 honeybees.
Mm-hmm. 100. As far as pollinating.
Yeah, I mean, and they're so effective because they literally plop right into the flower, and they're just full of all this pollen. and it's all over their body. And so their success rate in pollinating a flower, and then they go obviously to another flower, another tree, another fruit tree, whatever, they are 99.7% effective as a pollinator. 99, I mean, talk about the perfect bee.
Busy as a bee.
So, you know, this solitary bee, by the way, is rather tiny compared even to a honeybee. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you look at it, it looks like a fly. You know, it's that. But it has the bee's light yellow stripe on its abdomen.
I think that was a leaf cutter bee.
Oh, that was a leaf cutter bee. Well, that's the other one, by the way. The blue orchard mason bee and the leaf cutter bee. The orchard.
Now, they're out in the world right now.
Yeah.
We've probably seen them and not even known what they were.
I'm positive I have seen them.
I would think that the blue mason bee looks like a fly.
Yeah.
And it's kind of hairy compared to a fly, but I'm sure we've seen them, but we just didn't recognize them.
So what we decided to do is we contacted Crown Bees and we found different type of houses, because like a bird house, you can have a bee house. Now it could be a simple matter of a PVC tubing with a cap on the back and drilled holes for air ventilation, and then an extension kind of like a roof over a house. You know, you want an overhang.
Mm-hmm.
And then in this case, you could either use tubes, paper tubes, which you can buy, or if you really are industrious, you can simply make by taking a pencil, and where's the pencil?
Right here.
Oh, pencil. And basically just wrapping it or rolling it around a pencil, and then using a little bit of glue at the end to seal them, and you can make your own paper tube. So it's, you know, it's not a matter of economics, it's a matter of, is this something you want to do? And then of course you simply place your tubes inside of your house, whatever type of house that you have, and the mason bee and the leaf cutter bees, at their different times of year, they will actually go inside this tube. They will first drop some pollen back there, and then they will lay an egg, and then they'll go out and find some mud. So you have to have a little hole available someplace where there's moist dirt, mud, you know. And then they will actually seal that chamber with a little bit of mud. And then they go out, get more pollen, come back in, drop the pollen in, lay the egg, go back for some more mud, and they keep doing that, and they fill up the entire tube.
And that's why they call them mason bees, because they're using that mud as a clay barrier.
Right. Yeah. So, and again, you can buy the tubes if that's something that you prefer to do, or if you're industrious, you can make your own tubes. It doesn't really matter. Now, they also come with these great wood dividers. I thought I'd be really smart and I'd get a block of wood and just drill a bunch of holes, but oh no. If you do that, you're never going to be able to harvest them.
Or clean them.
So what I like about this system is it's a set of wood that have drilled holes in them. And so again, the mason bee or leaf cutter bee will go inside and do that same process in there. Now, why is all of this important? Well, you know, the mason bees are what's called spring bees. And so those are the ones when the flowers first come out, that's when you want to release them, or that's when you're going to notice that mason bees are around, because they're one of the early
bees, the
very early bees.
When your tulips are out and your crocuses and your daffodils, they're already out. So what you're saying is you want to be sure that when you put your bees outside, it's going to be at a nice 55 degree consistent temperature, so that you know that they aren't going to be killed off by a cold snap. And probably the best way to do that is go online and pull up a chart that gives you a month-by-month temperature range for your area, your local area. Now, that doesn't guarantee that there won't be a surprise in there, but, you know, usually you can go by those. When you order the bees, these are the leafcutter bees, and this is how they come in their little
they're still inside the nesting tubes or block. And when it's time for them to come out, then you open, they take the tape off and open them up, and there they are. These are the Blue Orchard Mason bees, and they come in a little box. They're inside there, depending on how many you order. And we purchased, now you could make your own, we purchased this little humidor. You know how people have humidors for cigars? It has a little piece of sponge on the bottom and a more open sponge on the top, because they have to remain moist inside there, especially if you have a frost-free refrigerator. And then it has a cover, and I put a sign on it so nobody would eat them or think they were something that they were going to eat. But they stay in your refrigerator from now until spring.
Well, not only that, but you also have a little chart on the side to remind yourself to go in and add some water every month to make sure that they are never without water.
They don't dry out.
And I notice there's also holes on here as well. Again, just
circulation.
For circulation, so it doesn't get musty. So you can see in my hand right now, I have two cocoons. I have a small one, which is the male, and a large one, which is the female. And these are the cocoons that you're going to be harvesting.
When my husband gets enthusiastic about something, he sometimes can't help himself. So he saw these different kinds of mason bee houses and decided we should try a variety of them. So as he showed you the PVC one, then there was this cute kind of a birdhouse one where you can put either the tubes or the blocks of wood. And then there was this beautiful tear-shaped one where, again, you place the blocks,
the tubes
inside. Yeah. Now, as you don't know how many you're going to attract, because once these are out there and there are other mason bees that you have put in there, they may attract the ones that are already in your yard, and they'll come join the ones that you have purchased. Which is wonderful, because then there's cross mating going on, and your hive is getting bigger. I shouldn't say your hive, your collection is getting larger. Now, do you have to go through all this trouble? Do you have to keep them in your refrigerator? No, you don't. You could just leave them in their houses for the entire winter and let nature take its course. By collecting them and keeping them, you are making sure that more of them will survive the winter, especially last year's winter here. So this is something that you can either start on a very small scale with just a house that you've made and paper tubes that you've built, and then just order some. Even maybe just put some out. Even if you haven't ordered any, just put it out and see what happens come spring. You may find that the local population will just love your house and come in. But otherwise, you can order them.
One of the other things about these houses, I mean, you know, you can build these, like Lynn said yourself, and you don't have to have wood blocks. You can use your paper tubes in here as well. But one of the things I liked about this teardrop one here is it actually has a Velcro, kind of like a little incubation house. This is where you would put your cocoons in, and when they're ready to fly out, they'll come out in their own hole.
They'll
and
hatch.
So you just stick that up in there, and that's why I thought that was kind of
a cool
design.
The shape is really cool too.
Now, where do you put these?
They have to be, well, for your most productive is going to be in the south, on the south side of your house, or the southeast, because that's where the sun comes up. That's where they're going to wake up sooner every morning and get out and get busy.
Because if you keep them in the shade,
they're going to
sleep in.
They're going to sleep in.
And so they're going to have a shorter day. They're going to do less pollination and so forth. But it's also important that you keep them within 300 feet of
the flowers. Trees or flowers that are blooming. Lilac trees, trees.
Yeah, these are great for fruit tree, nut tree pollinators as well.
Right.
But you've got to make sure that you've got flowers that are blossoming the entire season. Well, even for bumblebees. I mean,
Which
bumblebees,
are any bee.
are year-long. You know,
yes.
they live probably the longest, and I've found out they're the oldest.
Oh, yes.
There's a record going back to 30 million years, you know, so this is a pretty ancient and effective
yes.
bee having survived so long.
Right. So we hope you've enjoyed this introduction to solitary bees. Like we're telling you, this is our first experience with them, and we will keep updating you as we learn more and as we put them out, and we'll take pictures of them. And, you know, it's just nice to know that we can have bees. We don't have to worry about being stung, because they're just very friendly bees. They are not hostile to you. They will not hurt you in any way. You don't need big smokers
and nets.
Right.
If you do, and this is very rare, but if you ever got stung by a mason bee, it's like a mosquito bite.
Right.
And you don't go into?
Anaphylactic shock.
I always thought of prophylactic shock, but
They don't have that kind of venom in them.
No. And so they're very, very solitary, independent bees, and just great. But the reason we're presenting this video at this time, if you truly are interested, this is the time not only to do your research, but also the time to order.
If you're going to
experiment with this in your own garden or want to, you know, this is the time you want to put your order in for bees, because they go very quickly. And what I like about this particular company is they have a buyback policy.
Yes, they do.
So if you feel you have an excess when you harvest, you can actually send them to them, and they will pay you, because
right.
they will then distribute it to other farmers and gardeners in your area. So
right.
that's really cool. And like I said, this company is on a great mission, something we want to support. We don't receive any financial rewards
or extra bees.
Commissions or anything from them. We just believe they're on the right mission, and as a public service kind of thing,
yeah.
we wanted all of our viewers to see what's happening and maybe get involved as well. Maybe you'll become one of the 1 million gardeners that help us
okay.
Develop these super pollinators or encourage them.
Yeah.
I mean, we need all of them. It's not like one is better than the other, but here's a way you and I as gardeners can do something to help the environment.
Right. And if you have a garden club that you think this might be a good project for your garden club to do, or schools, that company seems to be very interested in working with schools and kids and getting them involved and letting them know how they can help the environment.
Well, they have an educational program.
Yep.
They have, I believe, videos. They have PDF files, lesson plans. And, I mean, they really have an affiliate or a discount program for clubs
yes.
who will get involved. So it might be a fundraiser that schools decide to get involved in.
Sure.
So, do some research. Check out these solitary mason bees. I think you will be amazed. You probably already have them in your garden, you just don't know it.
Right.
But here's a chance for you to get directly involved and help the pollination problem that we're starting to experience in our country and actually all around the world.
Right. If you enjoyed this video and you found it interesting, please give us a thumbs up. If you know about mason bees or leafcutter mm-hmm. bees, and you've been already involved with them and think that maybe we need some help.
Yeah, we'd love to hear from you.
We sure would love to hear from you. So please send us a comment or a question or some advice, some tips. And as always, if you'd like to join our garden family, please subscribe. Thank you so much for watching and being part of our garden family. Bye for now.